just like the river I've been running ever since. It's been a long, time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long, time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Telling me don't hang around. It's been a long, time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother. Say, brother, help me, please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my knees. Oh, there have been times that I thought I could last for long. But I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
Hey, guys, welcome, everybody. You know, Chalo's taking an important call, so he's gone right now. But I want to welcome some of our guests. We got Roger Denchuk, Christopher Kilby, Cocaine Cowboys, Ceci Escano, Doug Collier, Jib the Janus Batman, Upper Echelon, Big Vasquez. Welcome to the show, guys. It's going to be outstanding today, man. You know, I'm not a dynamic speaker like David is or Chalo. But, you know, I'm going to do my best, you know. This is going to be awesome. This is very special for David. Welcome, everybody. Let me tell you a little bit about what's going on today. What are we going to talk about today? This week is part two of our own David Contreras. David's resume is so impressive, man. His professional and accomplishments are so many. David started his law enforcement career with the California Department of Corrections and then moved to the San Diego Police Department. Today's episode focuses on David's journey through life and his experience becoming a correctional officer and a police officer for the city of San Diego. David will also highlight some of his most memorable cases. David is also a speaker at law enforcement venues and has provided lots of training throughout the United States, China, Colombia, Canada, and Mexico. David is also a co-author of the book, When the Music Stops, the Pain Begins. So we're going to start our episode today by watching this little little video.
Congratulations. Attention all units, all frequencies. Please join me in wishing a happy retirement to Sergeant David Contreras, who has served the San Diego Police Department for 26 years. Prior to being promoted to Sergeant on March 31st, 1999, he had already worked Central Patrol and in the gangs unit. As a Sergeant, David worked Northeastern Patrol, Southern Patrol, and as a Special Assistant to the Chief before becoming a Detective Sergeant in 2004. Since then, he has worked in Internal Affairs, the Gangs Unit, Criminal Intelligence Unit, and finally, Narcotics. David has has received over 30 commanding officer citations throughout his career, primarily due to his dedication and commitment to improving police and community relations and his proactive nature. Sergeant David Contreras, congratulations and good luck. ID 4403, 1042, Station A.
What happened?
That is so awesome right there. I mean, you know, that's that for people that are not in law enforcement, that's called last call. That's done to guys that have a lot of years of service in the department, and the department honors them by doing what's called last call. I remember my last call when I was driving, when all of a sudden I heard this beep, beep, beep. You know, usually when you hear that, it's going to be an emergency call. It's a hot call. And next thing you know, they start doing my last call. I was surprised. I mean, it's awesome when they do that. And I know David was very honored to do that. He did it at the skyline of San Diego. I mean, you could see all of San Diego from the rooftop where Abel lands. As you can see, Sean Murphy was there. Sean had dark hair.
Still do.
Is that who that ugly guy with glasses was behind him?
No, that was really no. Yeah, stop.
Yeah. No.
In the background, you can hear a kid yell, "Grandpa!" You know, that's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
So it's
good to have your family there. Awesome.
Let me tell you what happened. David got a commendation that's very unique and very rare. It's with San Diego PDs. It's called the Commanding Officer Citation. And let me tell you a little bit about that citation right there. I'm going to read what that citation said. You know, David only had 8 months on patrol and was still on probation and was in uniform when he wrote his first telephonic search warrant. I mean, most detectives fear their first telephonic search warrants. I'm talking about their first 3, 4, 5. They're in fear of it because it's something new. It's very unique. But David did a telephonic search warrant, and he received a commanding officer citation for his outstanding performance there. Let me tell you what the citation says. During the month of November 1989, Officer David Contreras, ID 4403, was assigned to the Logan Heights area of San Diego. During that time, several citizens expressed concerns to Contreras about drug dealing occurring along Imperial Avenue. On November 26, 1989, Contreras noticed an unusual amount of pedestrian traffic at 2754 and a half Imperial Avenue. After surveilling the residence, he was able to determine that narcotics were being purchased there. Contreras then obtained a telephonic search warrant for the drug dealer and residence. Knowing that the drug house was fortified, in other words, it had barred doors and windows, he summoned the assistance from the narcotics section for assistance. The execution of the warrant resulted in a safe entry into the house and the arrest of the drug pusher. Officer Contreras is commended for his creativity, ambition, and investigative ability during this incident. I'm telling you guys, David, as an experienced detective, I'm telling you, I commend you for your motivation, proactivity, and the can-do attitude at that early stage of your career, brother. David, you are an ambitious person who eagerly pursues what is right, man. David, we can't wait to hear the stories, and we're excited to be here with you and listen to your right. I mean, your story, dude.
Hey, David, you know, this was so awesome, bro. And as a chief of police, bro, and I love you like a brother, bro. I finally got to meet you in person one time and can't wait to continue to share more times together. But that you were born to do this, to this career, dude.
Yeah.
Good officers are born. They're not raised. They're not made. You know, we've all gone through that. We've all been FTOs at one point, or we had some people on earth. They say, how the hell did this guy make it or this person make it where he's at? I said, and you know what? Seeing this, David, you know, that should have given you a message from God telling you, David, son, this is your career. You will be good at it. You will do a lot of good stuff on it. And for your family to be watching this, bro, what an honor for them to experience this and hear us. You know, guys, you know, the positions we've all held, people we've all seen growing up through our careers, nobody gets to that level so soon. That's all I got to say, dude.
Awesome. Thank you, John. It means a lot coming from you. Thank you.
I mean, David, since I've known you, you've been highly motivated, and you always have that can-do attitude, and you're always so positive when we're down or when other people are down. You're always there for everybody, man. I mean, it's going to be awesome to be share the ride with you today, brother.
Thank you. So with all that said,
Sean, just go ahead and take it away.
Okay, enough said. David, tell us about the first 5 years or a few years on the department.
You know, first of all, guys, thank you very much. Let me just say what really happened that day. I had 8 months on. I was still on probation, Benny. And I remember, I mean, I could literally picture that day, that moment. My partner, Van Cruz, I think he had been on for about 2 years. He was 2 years before me. A guy named Bob Cristano and Mark Tallman had been on about the same time. They knew that, you know, that I spoke Spanish and I had worked the institution and that I knew the streets. So what we did, we went to the Value Village earlier in the shift and I bought a big long trench coat. And I actually bought the dope with the trench coat over my uniform. I had my police radio. I had my police uniform on. It was like 11 o'clock at night. I go knock on the door and these guys they're hiding behind bushes. We're answering radio calls at the time. And I never talked to them. I told my sergeant, I knock on the door. The guy yells, ¿Qué quieres? And I yell, quiero negra. Negra at the time was heroin. I go, ¿Cuántas quieres? Dame dos. You know, and I'm changing my voice too. But dude, I'm in full uniform. I'm on probation. I never asked my sergeant. Never ask anybody. I just did it, right? And he sells it to me. And what I did, I had my $20 bill. That's how much it was. It was two for 20, 10 apiece. And I wrote my social security number because I knew that when we came back later that evening, I was going to recover that money. And I could show the court that it was my money that I bought. And dude, I baited with my social security number on the $20 bill. I hand it to the guy. He gives me the cocaine. We go back. Dude, I didn't know anything about search warrants. Thank God Bob Cristano, Tallman, and Cruz were there. So we wrote down during all this time, we never told our sergeant, Chalo. And here, I'm on probation. They're not. So now I have it. And you know where it says right there that they called narcotics to serve the warrant? Dude, we didn't call narcotics. It was at 3 o'clock in the morning. We just went in. Dude, we did all this without telling our sergeant. And we went in and we got the dope. So now at the end of shift, I got to tell the sergeant, hey, I wrote a telephonic search warrant with the help of my partners. This is the dope that we got. Dude, I thought he was going to fire me. Literally, I thought he was going to fire me. The only thing that I could remember was my dad used to say, sometimes, son, it's better to ask forgiveness than ask permission.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Dude, and I'm telling you, we did all this without our sergeant knowing. And this is all in an 8-hour shift. And we're still answering radio calls. So I'll never forget that. I mean, that was an experience that I'll never forget. And I found that COC, and I thought that you might find it interesting. And Yuresh, Chris said that it was Operation Storm. But no, you know what? It was pouring down rain that day, but that was a great experience. But answering your question, the first 5 years, guys, before I get started, I just want to give a shout out. Once again, guys, this show is dedicated today to my four little beautiful grandchildren. Guys, 20 years from now, 5 years from now, when I'm dead, you're going to be watching this. I want you to watch this because the things that I'm going to talk about today, I've never talked to anybody, especially the one where we talk about the live liver donor transplant. I've never shared this story. Those of you that visited me, I'll mention you, but I've never shared this story on video. And I told myself that I would never, but you know, I want you to hear it from me because throughout the years, you're going to hear different stories. People are going to tell, some are going to embellish, some are not going to know, but they're going to talk about it. But today's episode is dedicated to you. 5 years from now, RJ, Luca, Anaya, Elijah, when you're going through hard times, 20 years from now, I want you to pick up your video, your iPad or whatever you may have by then. And you want to hear my voice. You want to hear what I went through. I want you to look at it. And hopefully one word that I say is going to give you that courage, going to give you that spirit to continue forward and making the right decisions in life. Guys, I also real quick, I know we only have an hour, want to just give my son, David. I have three children. My son, David Contreras, the third. I love him very much. He's a very special young man. The guy has so many gifts. I love you, Dave. Thank you for being my son. I'm honored to have you as my son. And I want to, my daughter, Vanessa, she's married to Kelvin. I got two beautiful grandchildren. They live here in Orlando. I love you. very much. Thank you for being patient with me and my daughter, Monique. Monique, she's married to Bobby Hernandez. I have two beautiful grandchildren with them. They live in Southern California. Thank you. Thank you for being a part of my journey. This show is dedicated to all of you. And to the most important women in my life. Last week, I showed you two women that were the most important women. They still are. My mom and my grandmother, my two sisters. But my mom, my grandmother passed away. And you know what? Well, they're with the Lord, but they're in my heart. Now these two women, God has tasked me to take care of them, to be by their side, for them to be by my side. My beautiful wife, Wavelin, I love you very much. I love you as much as I did the first day I saw you. And my mother-in-law, who's 90 years old, and she is struggling with different diseases. And I love you and thank you for being a part of my life. And that's a picture of my father-in-law, who was a great man. But guys, with that said, Sean, you asked me a question. The question was, what was the question, Sean? I'm sorry.
What was the first 5 years of your career like?
First 5 years of my career, I worked patrol. I worked Logan Heights. And I'll tell you, the first 4 years, I worked Logan Heights, and my partner was Van Cruz. Those of you that are watching the show that know Van Cruz know that that guy is a legend. He was my partner. If you see this picture, he's the one on the upper left-hand side with the sunglasses. This is my first squad right here. This is one of my first squads. And back then we had 12 people on the squad, 9 people on the squad. Now I don't know what they have now. But these guys are Logan Heights guys. All three of them, I've arrested them before, sent them to prison. And here I am right there by the patrol car, right there in Logan Heights, overlooking Coronado Bridge. Guys, working patrol, well, like I said, at 8 months, we served the search warrant. We were the type of squad that we literally would hit the streets after lineup. And within, I'm not exaggerating, an hour, we already had a felony arrest. I think the record that my partner Van Cruz and I had on felony arrest was 6 felony arrests, plus answering radio calls. Those of you that are cops understand, we had B responsibility, but we made 6 felony arrests in one time. And during that time, when we would make felony arrests, we would all go to headquarters, and then we'd get there, and then we'd they'd have a table, and we'd have our dope, our money, because everything was 11-350, 11-351, 11-550, 30-56. And those of you that are cops understand parole violation. I mean, parole, absconding parole, possession for sales, possession of heroin, possession of cocaine. I mean, we were rocking and rolling. And I did that for 4 years. And let me tell you, the reason why I got this picture up right here with these guys from Logan Heights, during the time that all of us, Chris Kilby, he was on my squad. He came, I believe, a year later after I had been on the squad. I think he's 1 year behind me in the academy or months. I'm not sure. But Chris was with us when we were working. When you guys hear about the Arellano cartel going into Logan Heights and recruiting all these kids, taking them to Tijuana, and they became hitmen, well, guess what? We were working. We knew those kids before the Arellanos did. And when the Arellanos came into the barrio to recruit these kids, we knew they were coming because we knew David Barron. We had chased them. We had chased all the guys that you hear about, the Arellano killers. We knew those guys. And we tried to help a lot of them, but a lot of them decided to go become hitmen. But I'll tell you, I thought that those 4 years were the best years of my career. But you know what? All of a sudden, I get transferred. I get transferred over to GST, the gang suppression team. The gang suppression team, for those that are watching, it's equivalent to when you watch or when you have the LAPD, what is it called? The crash unit. Well, that's our equivalent to the crash unit. This picture that you see right there, where there's this is a parole agent, really a great guy. And all of us were actually at the levee in San Ysidro. This is the border, what the border used to look like. And we went up there. I believe we were chasing somebody in San Ysidro, a parolee at large, a couple of gang members. And afterwards, we went up there to take the pictures. And this was Roberto Salinas, a SSU agent, a legend in SSU. And this is my squad right here. Manny Smith, best sergeant ever. This bald-headed guy is me. My partner right here, Jack Didlow, and Hector Hoyt. And Billy Cahill, that was our team. And man, we had a wonderful time. Somebody have a question, guys?
No, go ahead.
Well, like I said, those, I thought patrol was fun. Being in GST, working for Manny Smith, I'm telling you, one of the best sergeants I ever worked for. I love that guy. And I learned a lot from him, learned a lot from Hector, from Billy Cahill, may you rest in peace, and from Jack Didlow, man, outstanding cops. So I had a great time. So now I go over to investigations. But before I go to, before I went to investigations, I went to internal affairs. I worked there for 2 years. I worked for the chief of police. I was a special assistant to him and also to two chiefs, with David Bejarano and William Lansdowne. And you're going to hear a little bit more about what I did for them as we go on with this episode. But guys, I got a chance to run some great team as a detective sergeant. These guys, every picture you see up here, they're all legends. Not me. I was just I was blessed to be around these guys. And I'm not going to mention them all, but if you see these pictures, you know who they are. Chris, you know every one of these. Hector, if you're watching, these guys were outstanding. I worked narcotics, I worked gangs, and I worked criminal intelligence. And we're going to get into the criminal intelligence right now as we continue. But I'm telling you, we did some great cases while we worked criminal intelligence, gangs, especially gangs, and narcotics. But I had a wonderful time working those cases. Go ahead, Chalo.
Wow, David. You know what, David? And we all look at this, but wasn't our career one of the best career we could have chosen that God gave us? I mean, and it's all God's plan, man. It's just, I always say, you know what?
We're doing it too.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, we had ups and downs, and we did see a lot of ugly, but you know what? All in all, man, it was awesome, man. And David, just by you have all this passion, you feel excited talking about your career, man.
You know, Chalo, my father used to always say, and I know that he read it somewhere, but my father used to always say, if you love what you do, you never work a day in your life.
Exactly.
And you know what, Chalo? I know all of us here in this row, we never worked one day in our life. Guy, it appears that we lost it. I don't know what happened. Benny, people lost are what? Saying, damn, I lost it. Are people still watching it?
Somebody
said locked out. Wardo Gordito, a Chicago PD brother, said, and Roger said, I lost it. I guess we're still on, right?
Hang on, David. It's going in a little circle. I'm seeing it on the other screen.
Somebody's saying, what happened?
What happened? Ceci. Yeah, Ceci's going, what happened? Guys, yeah, and you know what? Let's continue.
It's going circle.
Yeah. Logged out, bro. You know what? Let's continue. People could watch it afterwards. Let's continue with the episode. People could hopefully watch it. Well, they will watch it afterwards. Well, Chalo, let's go with your next question.
Yeah. So, David, like I was saying, man, you know, awesome career, Ben. You know, we all had our setbacks, but made us stronger, made us a better person to continue our career. That's all I got to say. Hey, so David, real quick, like, you know, so tell us about some of your most memorable cases and moments that you had.
Well, you know what, Chalo? I'm going to talk about three memorable cases. We did a lot of great cases, but three that I want my grandchildren to see. But before I get started on this one right here, there's a saying by that Hemingway, I guess, I don't know, in one of his books, he was quoted saying this, and this is what he says. There is no hunting like the hunting of man. And those who have hunted armed men long enough and liked it never care for anything else thereafter. Have you ever seen that, Chalo?
No, it's the first time I see it, man.
Man, you know what?
True statement.
And with that said, I'm going to go ahead and jump into this case right here. October 12th, 2010, this beautiful young lady, Diane Gonzalez, may she rest in peace. Diane Gonzalez was a beautiful young lady. She married this individual right here, Armando Perez Borjon. Armando Perez Borjon, I believe, was 14 or 15 years older than her. He used to be at one time a Logan, not a gang member, but a heavy sympathizer. And he was jealous of her. He was very, very jealous of her because she was younger than him and she was beautiful. So they started having a lot of problems. Yeah, it looks like it crashed. A lot of people aren't it's crashing. But you know what? They'll be able to see this episode fully after we finish recording. Because remember what happened last time, Benny? We stopped and the episode continued. So we'll continue. Hopefully they'll be able to jump on. Okay, so it's October 12th. So they're having a lot of problems. 2 weeks before this murder, this guy, Armando Perez, you see his picture right there. Armando Perez goes and kidnaps her because she leaves him, goes back to her mom and dad's house. By then, they had a beautiful little, I believe, six-month little baby. Yeah. So he goes and he kidnaps her, and he takes her to a hotel in San Ysidro, and he rapes her. 2 weeks before this murder, San Diego PD, I believe it was the gang unit, there were some detectives, responded to the hotel. People were calling it in San Ysidro. They arrested him. The district attorney, which was Bonnie Dumanis, he was arrested for kidnapping, for rape, for domestic violence. I mean, they threw the book at him. She dropped the charges. She had them drop the charges. And they dropped the charges. So this is like, I believe a month before, not 2 weeks, a month before. So now, since they dropped the charges, he's free, out and about. Now, on October 12th, she was going to City College. She was a student there. So that day, she goes to the City College. When she walks back from her classroom, she's walking through the corridor. He was hiding on a tree and jumped on the second floor, grabbed her, threw her in the men's restroom, and started to stab her. He stabbed her numerous times. I'm not going to say hundreds, but he stabbed her numerous times. Not only did he stab her, but he also mutilated parts of her body. After he stabbed her, mutilated parts of her body, he runs out and he gets in his car and he heads to Mexico. When he gets to Mexico, I'm going to go in and go solo on this. When he gets to Mexico, now she's basically bludgeoned to death, body parts all over the place. I believe he even wrote with her blood. I'm not going to quote what he wrote on the mirror and on the walls with her blood. But let me tell you what happened. When our homicide team responded, they have their lab techs. The scene was so ugly, guys, was so ugly that when the lab techs walked in, the first thing they saw was the scene. Two or three lab techs, and even I believe one homicide detective, had to walk out because they had daughters the same age as this young lady. One of the lab techs that was there had been there for many years. She ended up leaving, ended up retiring from the police department because that's how horacious, how horror this scene was. And, you know, our homicide team, guys, they respond to hundreds of throughout their careers of different scenes. But this scene was definitely one of those scenes that you never forget. So he goes to Mexico. Well, at the time, I was assigned to criminal intelligence. I had a great team of guys working with me, and we were working in Mexico at the time. Since he's in Mexico, now they basically say, David, go get him. My team and I hooked up with the U.S. Marshals, with a U.S. Marshal named Frankie Sanchez and Jesus Guerrero. We worked up with the former chief of police. He was the liaison, Alejandro Lares, and Charlie Betancourt. And guys, we worked this case for 2 years. And when I say we worked this case for 2 years, guys, I mean day and night, we worked this case. I was up at 3 o'clock in the morning. We were surveilling houses. We were using the Tijuana surveillance teams, their SWAT teams. I'm not exaggerating. During the 2 years, we must have hit at least 15 houses at 3 in the morning, 5 in the afternoon, all over Tijuana, because we were looking for this guy. And finally, it was Oscar Armenta, who was my partner and my detective at the time. He basically broke the case. And I'm not going to get into specifics because this guy's doing life and I don't want him to, I'm sure in prison today, he's watching this video. I don't want him to have any ammunition on who our sources were. But one of the things that myself and Oscar were very good at is turning individuals into confidential informants. We were very good at that. I mean, that's where our expertise was at. And we ended up turning certain individuals that were close to him at the time into our confidential informants. And like I said, this was one of those cases that every time I would go and brief Chief Lansdowne, he was the chief of police at the time, once a week, every Thursday. And for 2 years, every time I would walk in to brief him on Mexico, what we were doing in Mexico, myself, my Lieutenant Andy Mills, best lieutenant and now chief of police in Palm Springs that I've ever worked for, would walk in and I'd give him the briefing. He would always end, "When are you going to catch him?" After a year and a half, he would actually mock me. I would walk into the elevator and he literally, the elevator at headquarters was full. And as I'm walking in, he would go, "Here comes David. Are you going to catch him now?" I mean, he would literally, Chief Lansdowne, for whatever reason, I don't know if it was a motivational tool that he was using, but he would mock saying, "Yeah, you're going to catch him now." Because I go, "Chief, we're very close." "Yeah, it's been 2 years." So let me tell you what happened. So as we're, and I'm not going to get into deep into the story, but we did a lot of operation. This guy, as you see him here in this picture, he was an animal, but at the same time, he was a genius. He would dress like a woman. He would dress like a cholo. He would dress like a millionaire. He would have dogs. I mean, this guy, he would dress like a homosexual. I mean, this guy had different costumes that he would basically put on to change his appearance. So we had hit numerous houses. We had information that he was going to be at a certain place, certain time for 2 years. I mean, thank you, my beautiful wife, for being patient. I mean, this thing, this case took, afterwards, I tallied it up, over 300 hours of my time, of my team's time to catch this guy. But let me tell you the night that we caught him. The night that we caught him, we had information from a very good source that he was going to be in La Coahuila, which is a seedy part of Tijuana. He was going to be in a bar and waiting for somebody to bring him some money. We get there. First of all, it's, I believe, February 9th. I think it was 2012. It took me 2 years to catch him. And I received that call from Oscar, said, "Sarge, he's right now going to be at 2:30 in the morning at this, at La Coahuila, at this cantina, and this is the time we're going to catch him." And even I was like, how many times have we been to La Coahuila? How many times have we been to Matamoros? How many times have we been to La Mesa? How many times have we been La Pancho Villa? These are all colonias that we were chasing him at. But that night I go, "Oscar, let's go." So we called our two U.S. Marshals of the United States. One of them was out partying, having a great time. He wasn't on call, but we call him. We go, "Hey, listen, I'm not going to say which one, but we call him. We go, listen, we need your help, man. He's going to be here." Really? Again, even we were doubting each other. Now it's 12 o'clock at night. I go, "Guys, we're meeting down at Southern, down by the border, and we're going to gear up." And I already got Lattis. He was a liaison in Mexico. Later became the chief of police, and I got Charlie Bencor. They're waiting for us, and we're crossing the border. By the time we cross the border, it's 1 o'clock in the morning. We go to where the bar is. And I don't know, those of you that have been to Tijuana, have been to La Coahuila, Adelitas, El Hong Kong, and all these other bars are all in that area. We drove in, and Tijuana on a Friday night is like downtown. It's like the Yankee Dodgers game. Thousands of people everywhere. It looks like daylight, but it's night. Thousands of people everywhere. We know because we have a source that's telling us he's in this bar right now. So back then we had our phones, but I sent Oscar and I sent Frankie, which was the U.S. Marshal, and I sent Charlie Bencor. They were the best-looking guys. I was old already. Lattis, he was with me. He was a former chief of police. And Jesus, estaba feyito. No, I'm just kidding. Jesus stayed with us, and we were basically, we didn't tell no cops because he had a lot of cops that he was paying off. He was working a lot with the Arellano cartel. I mean, this guy was a very dangerous individual. So we basically send those three guys. They're all undercover. They walk into this bar. Next thing you know, the moment of my life, I'll never forget. It was 2 years of my life that it took. All of a sudden, and during this time, I'm meeting with Diana's mom and dad. Every week I'm meeting with them. I'm giving them reports. For 2 years, I'm going over. I'm bringing them food. I'm bringing them water. I'm telling them, please be patient. Have you heard anything? This is what we're doing. I'd keep them updated, but not secret information, but information. So as we're working the case, all of a sudden, Oscar texts me. I remember we were outside. There's a 7-Eleven there, and we're in Tijuana. No, it was an Oxxo in Tijuana. We're there, and then all of a sudden, I get the page. We got him. We have eyes on him. And then I'm like, okay, Oscar, you want me to go? And he goes, no. As soon as he goes in the bathroom, we're going to take him down. I go, okay, perfect. So we're standing outside, only three of us. We're not telling no cops, even though Charlie and Lares, they're Tijuana municipal police officers. Lares was a chief, but not the chief. Liaison chief. But I tell them, don't tell anybody, because if somebody está en la nómina, in other words, somebody's paid off, they're going to call him and he's gone. Because like I said, this guy was very smart. All of a sudden, Oscar says, David, he's going in the bathroom now. When he says he's going to the bathroom now, like I told you, we're all in Levi's, Pendletons, we're all in plain clothes. We start walking up the stairs. As we're walking up the stairs, there's tecatos everywhere, viejas everywhere. I mean, it's like Coahuila, you know? And as we're walking in, we walk in, there's a stripper dancing. Strippers, not one, a couple of strippers dancing. By now, Oscar clings on to me. He goes, the bathroom's right there. He's in there. I go, let's go. So we basically form a line. I go, guys, as soon as we walk in, Lares, you and Charlie, since you guys are Tijuana cops, we all had handcuffs. I go, you're Tijuana cops. You guys take a lead, man. You guys have the guns. You guys take a lead. As soon as we walk in, we don't see him. But there's a three toilet stalls. Lares opens one, nothing. And he and Charlie opens another one, nothing. So their hands are tied. So I open one. And I'm the one that basically, when I opened it, he basically attacks me, jumps at me. When he jumps at me, I throw him on the ground. He starts fighting us. As he's fighting us, I'm basically trying to restrain him. Lattice is on him. Oscar, we're all basically trying to restrain him. A knife falls out. We're fighting with him. And this is a dirty, filthy bar. Piss everywhere. I mean, there's probably shit all over the place. You know what I mean? I mean, because we're slipping and we're on the ground fighting with this guy. So finally, I get his hands behind his back. Lattis gives me the cuffs. We handcuff him. Now we pick him up. And by now, there's a line outside. And this is a whorehouse, guys. So now there's a line sitting outside. And as the line's out there, they're yelling. He starts. We handcuff him. We're taking him out. Now we're taking him out of the bathroom door. He starts yelling, secuestro, 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 which means kidnapping. That's what he's saying. Kidnapping. They're kidnapping me. And as we're walking out, you see this picture right there. He's bleeding from his head. He's bleeding all over the place. And as we're walking out, he's yelling, secuestro. The manager calls the police.
Oh.
And Lattis has his badge out, policía. And he's yelling, this guy's yelling, son cartels, me están secuestrando. Their cartel, they're kidnapping me. They're kidnapping me. He's yelling it. And as we're walking out, people are getting in our way. I'm literally, I got him by the back. Oscar has the other hand. I'm literally grabbing people, throwing them out of the way. Literally throwing people out of the way. Frankie's leading the way. Chuy's leading the way. Lattis is behind us fighting with people. I mean, there's a huge fight, and we're walking with this guy bleeding everywhere. So now we got to go down the stairs. And the stairs, going up was easy. Going down, holding this guy, and he's yelling, secuestro, me están matando, cabrones. He's yelling like crazy. We're going down the stairs. Guys, when we hit down the stairs, as we hit the street, there's about probably 25 Tijuana police officers with lights and sirens pointing their AR-15s at us. Pointing their AR-15s. When I see that, I'm holding him and he's bleeding, right? And Oscar has him. I go, ay, cabrón. I go, oh my God. So I look, Lattis is in the back fighting. I go, Lattis. I'm yelling at Lattis. Lattis comes up. I go, and they're all, pongan las manos arriba, cabrones. Put your hands up. Move, go, move. Let them go. And I'm not going to let him go. It took 2 years of my life, 300 hours to catch this guy, and I'm holding him. And all of a sudden, Lares goes, comandantes, comandantes, soy el jefe Lares, soy el jefe Lares. And then these guys were cocked and loaded. I mean, there's 20 cars out there because they got there quick. because they called sequestro in progress, kidnapping in progress. So they see Lares, so they all shake hands with Lares. So they go, Lares, and then Lares, they go, we'll put him in our car. I go, no, 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 you're not going to put him in your car. Lares had a truck. So what we did with lights and sirens, I go, Lares, go, let's put him in the police. I go, no, he's not going to go. It took me 2 years, took us 2 years to catch him. He's not going to get away now. So what we did, and it was pouring down rain. So what we did, we picked him up and threw him in the back of a truck bed, one of those police trucks. You know, you've seen them in Mexico where all the cops are in the back. I don't know where Oscar got the strength, Benny, and I got the strength, but this guy's a big dude. This guy weighs about 200 pounds. Dude, we picked him up, like literally, we threw him with handcuffs over the bed of the truck. He lands on there. When he lands on there, Oscar jumps in the back. Jesus Cesena jumps in the back. Frankie jumps in with me. Charlie and Lattice take off. And now we're going literally 100 miles an hour, and it's pouring down rain. And I'm on the police radio because I have their frequency. I'm telling Lares, slow down. Se van a matar. You're going to kill Oscar, because they were moving. I mean, they were in the back of the truck, and it's pouring down rain. So that's how we caught him. That's how we caught him. It took us 2 years. But the irony of this story is this. He murdered a beautiful, innocent young lady. He murdered her in a bathroom in the United States at a university, at a college, city college. We caught him in a dirty, filthy, toilet-filled restroom. And, you know, that's where we caught him. 2 years later, we caught him there. But, guys, because I got two other stories that I want to get to, but I just want to say this. This is very interesting, very interesting. After we caught him, my wife and I, we had bought a condominium in Fort Lauderdale. And this is before I moved there. This is in 2012. We had just bought the condo. We used to go like maybe once a year and just go for 2 or 3 weeks. And then I'd come back and work. And then I'd go once a year to my condo. I had just caught this guy maybe about a week before, days before. And I told my wife, I need a vacation. So we went to our condo. And my wife will testify to this. As we're getting into the condo, we have all our luggage with us, and I'm tired, I'm exhausted. We're walking into the elevator. There's this woman that is coming, and she says, hold the door, hold the door. And she had an accent. She was actually Irish. Later on, we found out she was Irish. She goes, hold the door, hold the door. And I go, yes, ma'am. We were on the 14th floor. I don't know what floor she was going to. But she gets in the elevator, and as the door closes, I hit the number 14 button. And when I hit the 14 button, as we're going up, she goes, excuse me, sir. She taps me on the shoulder. And I look at her. I go, yes, ma'am. What can I help you with? And she looked at me. She goes, there's a young lady here. She goes, I'm a medium. And I know you're not going to believe this. I'm here to give a reading to somebody on the 17th floor. I just need to tell you that there's a beautiful young lady here. And she wants me to tell you thank you. And she wants me to tell you to please take yellow roses to her mom when you go home. And she goes, I don't know you. I don't know. I will never see you again in my life. But I just need to tell you, she wants me to tell you thank you. And I looked at her and go, for what? She goes, she just wants me to tell you thank you and take her mom yellow roses. The door opened. Both my wife and I walked out. We didn't get it. We're like, what the heck was that? You know what I mean? We're like, and then all of a sudden my wife goes, do you know if Diane's mother likes yellow? I go, I think I've seen yellow roses at her house because we were going every week. And she goes, it was Diane. You know, I don't believe in a lot of those things, but I'm just telling you, you know, if it does exist or if it doesn't, that's neither here or there, but I will tell you that this case right here, it took 2 years of my life, and I'm telling you, it was well worth it. He's doing now life without parole. He was convicted for her murder, and her baby now is several years old, and someday I will take her mom yellow roses. Someday I will take her mom yellow roses. This is a case that I will never forget, because you know what? when I was working in Mexico, in four and a half, five years, we brought 17 homicide suspects. We helped LAPD. We helped the sheriffs. We helped the LA sheriffs, Long Beach PD, Green Bay PD, New York PD. We would go with their guys to go hunt these guys. So when they say that there's no hunting, like hunting our men, I'm telling you, I got a chance to experience that. It was a wonderful experience. And may you rest in peace, Diane. And someday I will take those yellow roses to your mom. May you rest in peace. Now, the second case that I want to talk about, this one was very interesting. And guys, I'm not going to worry about the 1 hour mark, because you know what? If people want to turn it off at 1 hour, God bless you. You could watch it later. But this is my chance for my grandchildren to see this. So when they get older and they're going, you're going to hear the next story. This is for them. This one right here was very interesting. Lieutenant Colonel Julian Leisaola, if you guys get a chance, go to Prime or Amazon Prime, and you could watch this video. It's a great video. It talks about Mexico's bravest man. This man right here was a lieutenant colonel in the military, retired. Then he went and worked for the state police for just a couple of months, a year maybe, and then he became the chief of police in Tijuana. When he became the chief of police in Tijuana, that's me and him, him and I in Ciudad Juarez. Because after he left Tijuana, he went to Ciudad Juarez. But when he was in Tijuana, he fired over 100 men, police officers, 100 police officers in a one-year period, because they were dirty. They were basically working for different cartels. Teniente Coronel Leisaola, Lieutenant Colonel Leisaola, he declared war on the Arellano cartel and on the Sinaloa cartel. Back then, we didn't have the Cartel Nueva Generación Jalisco, and La Familia Michoacana was not in Tijuana at the time. It was only Arellanos and Sinaloa cartel. During the year when I got transferred to Tijuana, they killed 35 Tijuana police officers. Out of the 35, I went to at least 15 of those funerals representing the San Diego Police Department. My lieutenant at the time, Andy Mills, went to one, and someday I'm going to have a special episode just on him, the things that he did in Mexico to open the doors for us. I'm telling you, that man is a true leader. Someday, Andy, I'll be telling my grandchildren stories about you. So I had gone, and I had established a good working relationship with the Tijuana Chief of Police, Teniente Coronel Leisaola. In America, we have a law called the Tarasov law, where basically if we have corroborated information that they're going to kill somebody, we are obligated to tell the victim that they are basically going to die. We can't tell them who's going to do it, but we're going to tell them, be careful because somebody put a hit on you. And basically we can tell them if we want who's going to do it, but the majority of the time, how we get this information, it's because we have cases going in the United States where we're listening to phone calls and narcotics, for example, DEA, ATF, special task forces, they're on a wire and they hear it. So they would at times call me to go and meet with Leisaola. On three occasions, we went across the border because I had a working relationship with him. And we told him, hey, listen, you have, this one wasn't my case, but I'm going to use this case as an example. I did three other cases with him, and I'll mention one of them. But this one was a case, I believe DEA had information, or the FBI had information, that the Sinaloa cartel wanted to murder him, wanted to kill him. They put like a $5 million hit on him, on Teniente Coronel Leisaola, when he was the chief of police, because like I said, he declared war on the cartels. And on this occasion, what happened was Lieutenant Leisaola always loved the military. He was a man that, while he was a chief of police in Tijuana, he lived in the military barracks. He lived with the men and women in Tijuana, which was in La Colonia Pancho Villa. That's where the big military base was, and he lived there. Leisaola always had 35 municipal police officers that were part of his SWAT team, basically two cars in front, two cars in back, and everybody was armed with AR-15s, grenades. I mean, these guys were armed to a teeth. That was his security detail, plus he had military. But one of the things that Leisaola, because he loved the military, would always do, whenever they'd be driving around the city, he'd be going to one meeting to another. If he ever saw a convoy of military personnel, he would stop them. He would put the lights and sirens on, and he would stop his entourage of police officers, and he would get out, and he would call the commanding officer to come out, and he would shake his hand. And once in a while, he'd go around shaking 10, 20 military guys, because he was proud to be a retired military. And the cartels knew that. They knew that he had that pattern because they had been watching him. They knew that every time he would see a military convoy, he would stop them. That's the only time he would ever get out of his car. Other than that, whenever he'd go to a meeting, he'd have his team go out, inspect the area, and then he would walk out, but not there. So what they did, they basically planned, they got cartel members from the Sinaloa cartel, and they cloned a military convoy with 50 caliber machine guns in the back. These guys, they had cloned military cars, uniforms, and they dressed like military. And they saw when he left La Pancho Villa, he left the barracks, and a couple of miles down as he was coming, the convoy was supposed to basically see him. They knew that he was going to stop, and that's where they were going to assassinate him. Well, I believe it was the DEA or FBI received the information. They went and they told them. And when that day, when that happened, they had the helicopters, everybody in the military, the real military guys came in, and they ended up arresting like 30, 40 guys. They were all dressed like military. On one of my cases that I went, one of his bodyguards, one of the SWAT team members, was going to assassinate him. And it was myself, Andy Mills, and Oscar Armenta. We went and we met with him, and we told him, listen, we know who it is because we had received information on the wire that Sinaloa was really after him. And he ended up saying, he goes, okay, David, we will take care of it. Later on, we found out that he ended up arresting the guy, sent him to prison. Another one that we went to advise him, one, like I said, he would never have a pattern, but one of the patterns that he had was he would once in a while go to a certain place where they sold juices, and he would always order the same juice. Well, they had the woman making the juices paid off, and they were going to poison him. And that was another one that we went, we had the information, we saved his life on that one. And the other one, I don't have the time to talk about, but I'm telling you, this man right here, a great man. But one day I get a phone call from a CIA operative in San Diego that was working in San Diego, was working actually in Mexico at the time. We started working with him. One of the things, like I said before, my team and I, we were very good at was developing sources. We, every time we went across that border, we were mission oriented. I mean, we were purpose driven and mission oriented. My team, I'll tell you the difference between my team and many other teams. I, working in Mexico as liaisons, I would hear other departments always say, oh, with a beer and with tacos, we could get anybody to tell us information. I'll tell you, when I took over that team in 2009, I worked there till the beginning of 2014 when I went to narcotics. I'll tell you, I never, not one time, had one drink. I never had one drink while I traveled to Mexico, while I worked in Mexico. I faked it a lot. I mean, they'd buy us. We had a budget where we would buy them drinks. We would want to get them drunk and get their information because that was our way of developing informants. But we never, my team, they were prohibited. Because our mission was to go and develop sources for America, for us. So now I get a phone call because everybody's hearing that I'm pretty close with Leisaola. So I get a phone call from this operative and he says, David, I need you to bring Leisaola across. And it was during the time that, I mean, everybody wanted to kill Leisaola. And he goes, bring him. I need to talk to him. They were trying to recruit him. And I go, okay. I go, give me a month to work on it because I go, I got to get logistics. I got to get SWAT set up. We'll have dinner at Fleming's downtown. I'm going to bring my lieutenant, bring some of my team members, but I'm going to have everything set up because they could kill him in Mexico. And they could kill him in downtown San Diego just as much because we had cartel members living there. So we did, and we did a lot of work with the CIA at the time, but I can't get into it. But that time, that moment, I remember he goes, okay, the meal's on me. It's on the government. You guys eat whatever you want, and the meal's on us. Just during the meal, basically, don't walk away, but let me have a moment with him. I go, yeah, no problem at all. So I told Isaole, the businessman, I didn't want to lie to him, but I wasn't going to front this man off. I go, there's a gentleman that does a lot of work, business work with our government. He wants to meet with you. And they say, I want to go say, hey, David, do you trust him? I go, I know him, but he wants to meet with you. You would do me a favor if you would go across the border and meet with him. He goes, okay, let's name the time and date. So now we may name the time and date. We meet at Fleming's. We got everything set up outside. We got undercovers. We got snipers. They bring their people. They bring up 35 guys, Tijuana. I mean, the whole area was shut down. We walk in the restaurant. We have our dinner. And the thing that Andy Mills always, even today, always laughs about is he goes, at the end of the meal, I mean, I knew the government was paying for it. And I'm a big steak lover. And I love wine with my steak. I ordered the most expensive wine. I ordered the biggest steak. Andy Mills orders the biggest steak. We ordered appetizer. We ordered dessert. And we're all eating, having a great time. And as we're there, all of a sudden, I remember all of a sudden, the guy goes, you know, now I'm going to order an after drink. He goes, the CIA guy, and he goes, and my after, he spoke perfect Spanish, by the way. He goes, my after drink is going to be, and he tells the waiter over, he goes, bring me your most expensive scotch, but only with three ice cubes. Only three ice cubes. I guess he saw that in a James Bond movie, right? So we're all amazed, and all of a sudden the waitress looks, or the waiter looks at us, he goes, sir, would you like something? I'll go, I'll have the same, the most expensive scotch with three ice cubes. And then Andy Mills, which is not a scotch drinker, they go, what would you like? The most expensive scotch, Oscars, those, all of us, even Leisaola, he looks and he goes, el escocés más caro con tres hielos. You know, and I go, and I interpret it for him. So they bring us the most, I mean, it was a little cup like this. It was probably $100 for this much scotch with three ice cubes. So we drank it, and then about that time, I saw the gentleman reach out to Leisaola, and they're having a little conversation. We're over here laughing because we just had a great meal on the government. The bill was like $5,000, but they paid for it. As soon as we're walking out, Leisaola puts his arms around me. First of all, we're on the radio. I got Oscar on the radio. Hey, is it clear to walk out? Yes, give us a second. We got his team coming in. Team 2's walking in. All right, send up Diamond. We're walking out. Before they all showed up, Leisaola puts his arm around me and he goes, gracias, David. Thank you, David, for this wonderful meal. And I go, you're welcome. And he goes, lo mandé a la chingada, which basically says, I sent him to hell. And I go, okay. I go, okay. And he goes, I knew who he was. He goes, I worked with him when I was in Fort Benning, being trained by them to fight the cartel. So I knew who he was. But you know what? We ate good and we had good scotch with three. And he starts laughing. Con tres hielos, cabrón. And we start laughing. But it was funny because, I mean, Leisaola, guys, if you get a chance, I got to go into the next episode because you know what? It's already the 1 hour, but it's okay. I'm going to finish it. But if you get a chance, watch that episode. Today, he sits on a wheelchair. He might be the next Tijuana chief of police again. They tried to kill him. They finally got to him when he was living in Juarez. It's a beautiful story. You know what? Someday we're going to have him on our show. I promise we're going to have him on our show. He's still a very dear friend. I have the utmost respect for him. And especially if he becomes the chief of police, con más razón, We're having Chief Wall next week, Scott Wall, San Diego. Now let's bring the Tijuana Chief of Police, and we'll talk about this story. I don't know if you'll talk about the CIA, but we'll definitely talk about our great stories together. But guys, this next one here, now we're going to go into a next one. This one right here is never have I shared this story with anybody. Well, people that know me personally know about it. People here in Florida, I'm always at, when I was living in Fort Lauderdale, I was at the beach every day. They'd see me and I have several scars going down. My wife calls it the Mercedes-Benz scar. And people call it the dead man scar because it's that scar that when you die, when they basically open you up, the coroner's office, it's that scar. And I have it coming down my stomach. And when you're in the beach, you never have a shirt on. At least I never do. And I'd be walking around and people would be looking at me, pointing at me. Some people would say it's a heart attack. Other people, he got shot. I mean, they'd make their own stories of what really happened. But today, my grandchildren, this story's for you. Because like I've said before, someday you're going to hear so many stories, but this is what really happened. My father, as you could see him right here, my father was a great man. He was a great man. He was a pastor. My father never drank liquor in his life. My father never smoked a cigar, never smoked in his life. My father, at a young age, gave his life to the Lord. He became a pastor, and he loved being a pastor. But he was one of those pastors that he would work all day long, and all of a sudden, at night, he will go preach. And then in the morning, he was a cement finisher. He would go to work for many, many years. You would see my dad's hands. They were calloused, a strong man's hands. But at the age of 60 years old, he is diagnosed with cirrhosis of the liver. And when he was first diagnosed, as you could see him, he's a big man, strong man, great man. And here's him and I standing. We're the same height, 5'11". And he is diagnosed with cirrhosis of the liver. And I remember thinking, how can my dad have cirrhosis of the liver? It's usually tecatos. It's usually drunks. It's usually people that never took care of themselves that have this. But later we found out when he was a little boy, my dad only had a third grade education. He lived in Tijuana when they had the Rio. Now you have the Colonia Rio or Rio de Tijuana. Dude, he lived on the Rio. And they used to drink the water from the river. So he got, I believe, hepatitis A at the time as he was a little boy. And throughout the years, finally got him through cirrhosis of the liver at the age of 60 years old. So now he has cirrhosis of the liver and he's getting worse, surely getting worse. And those of you that know a little bit about liver transplants, you know that you need to have a certain number that you have to reach to be eligible to get a liver transplant. Well, my dad, for whatever reason, wasn't there yet to get a liver transplant, but he was dying. He was dying. And what I decided to do, I was a cop at the time. I was working, where was I working? I was working at the chief's office. I was the chief special assistant. I would drive him places. I was always with the chief. He needed something. I was a liaison to the Latino community, to the Arab community, Jewish community. And then I handed that job over to two other outstanding guys, but I stayed with the Latino community. And wherever the chief would go, I'd be by his side. So now I'm working for the chief and all of a sudden my dad's dying. So my wife and I start doing research and we see that there's a program that's fairly new in America. This is 2003. This is 2003. It's fairly new in America. So I tell my dad, Dad, I want to donate my liver to you. I want to donate 60% of my liver. They leave. They say you only need 40% to survive. I'm going to donate 60%. At first, he said, I can't let you do that. And I go, I can't let you die. I love you, and I cannot let you die. Finally, as he's getting worse, he finally agreed and said, you know what? I want to continue being a pastor. I want to continue saving people. And the only way that I could do it is if you could help me save my life. And I never took it like saving his life. I took it as an honor to do this for him. So for this is in January of 2003. I had to go to UCLA every Monday for 2 months. And I started off, once I got approved to go through the liver donor transplant program, I had to go every Monday on my day off. I had Saturday, Sunday, Mondays off. And on Mondays, I would go to UCLA at 5 o'clock in the morning. I didn't want to get that Long Beach traffic. Those of you that are watching the show definitely know about that. So as I'm going at 4 o'clock in the morning, I would go and I would spend 8 hours. And they would do every test imaginable on me. I mean, they did one test almost at the end. You would start off at zero, and every week you would gain points. I had to reach 100 points. So every week they'd say, okay, you're 15 points in. Okay, you're 30 points in. You're 80 points in. So I did that for 2 months on my day off. And I would leave at 3 a.m. and I would go and then come back that night. And I'd go back to work for the chief. So finally, I would say probably the middle of March, I had completed. And I would see psychiatrists. On one occasion, I'll never forget, I went to one of my, and they had to get a live liver sample from me, but they couldn't shoot me up with no anesthesia because it needed to be completely pure. So what they did, I remember that day, I had just bought some brand new jeans. I'll never forget. Had bought some brand new jeans. They go, and I knew exactly, it was at UCLA. That's where I would go to UCLA. I knew exactly where to park, where to go. And I go in there, and the doctor, I would see different doctors all the time. But Dr. Gobriel, he was the main doctor. This man right here, the man's my hero. The man's a savior, man. God used him. And I'll talk about that right now. So I would go, but I remember on this time, I already had gone for about a month and a half. And when I walk in, the doctor goes, this is going to be very painful. And I go, I've had everything done to me, including seeing a psychiatrist. I could take it. They go, okay. And I remember I had brand new jeans. Remember that. They laid me down. And when they laid me down, he goes, I'm going to come in. He goes, I'm going to hit you right here on the side by your rib. And I'm going to hit it. And then you're going to feel a pinch. And he goes, and it's going to go quick. I go, okay, no problem. And I'm sitting there thinking, here we go again. Guys, he stuck a blade, a needle, all the way inside. It was quick, but I will never forget the pain. And he actually took a live sample from my liver. And the reason why I'm saying that, because I remember that when that happened, I literally was out of breath. And I immediately tried to get up to hold my side. And when I got up, I went back down. I didn't faint, but I remember it hurt. And I remember all of a sudden I'm laying there, I'm holding myself, and he goes, hey, we cannot compromise this sample. He never gave me anything, but I remember when I left, my jeans were soaked. My jeans were completely soaked of the pain that I was in. But, you know, that's what motivated me. And I remember that day he goes, all right, you're at 175, 180. You need 20 more points. And then the last one, I had to see a psychiatrist. And I'm thinking, I've gone through hell and back every Monday. Now I got to see a psychiatrist. And when I walked in, the first thing that psychiatrist says, do you want to kill yourself? And I go, no. He goes, why are you doing this? What do you do? I go, I'm a police officer. He goes, did you know that you will probably never be a police officer again? And I go, what do you mean? I never thought about it. He goes, you know, if things go wrong, you might die on that table. Or number two, you may never be the same. Your liver may never be the same. You may never be a police officer. And I remember when he told me that, I looked at him thinking, I never thought about that. I have my wife. I have my family. I never thought about that. But, you know, that was, and then at the end, I go, did I pass? He goes, you'll hear. And I left. And then about a week later, I get a phone call from Dr. Gobriel. He goes, David, congratulations. You made the 100 points. You're ready. You're a candidate. And I go, doctor, let me know when the surgery is going to be so I could prepare. I'm a police officer. I work for the chief. I want to make sure I got coverage. I want to make sure I'm set. He goes, oh, the surgery isn't going to be till, when is it convenient for you? I go, September, October. That's good for me because the chief usually goes out during that time and I could basically take a couple of weeks off. He goes, David, it's not going to be weeks. I go, well, I could take time off. September. He goes, David, he goes, we'll start scheduling it for September, October. Now we're in April. So about a week before, April 23rd, mark that date, April 29th, about a week before, my wife feels a lump in her breast. And her name is Wavy. She feels a lump and she says, David, you know what? I got a lump and it appears to be growing. I'm going to go see my doctor. She goes and sees her doctor and they do a biopsy. They get the biopsy. And when she gets home, that this is about 4 or 5 days before April, April 29th. She gets home. She goes, David, she goes, I need you to do me a favor. RJ and Luca, Anaya, Elijah, remember this. She says, I need you to do me a favor. I go, what is it, Wavy? And I love my wife. She goes, if I have cancer, I'm going to need you, because I haven't given her results yet. She goes, I'm going to need you to be by my side. And I know you're going to have this surgery with your dad, but if I have cancer, I need you to cancel. I go, Wavy, first of all, if you have cancer, I'm telling you, they're probably going to find it. I'll be with you till September. You'll be fine by then. And then September, I'll have my surgery for my father. She goes, that's fine. But promise me that if something happens, I mean, just like that, she goes, promise me if something happens that you are not going to go have that surgery until I heal. I go, Wavy, I give you my word. Thinking this is like April 25th. Well, 26, 27, 28, 29, on that morning of the 29th, before I went to work, I was driving back around because I had to drive around to certain locations where there could be some problems. I was his driver for certain locations, not all the time. But on that time, he was going to Logan Heights to Chuy's restaurant. The Chicano Federation was having a big luncheon, and he was going to be the keynote speaker. That morning, she told me, David, please be free at 2 o'clock because they have my results of my biopsy, and the doctor's going to give me my results. I go, yeah, Wavy, no problem. So I told the chief, hey, I'm going to take you as soon as it's over, I'm going to drop you off. I'm going to go, and then I'll come back if you need me something. Or he goes, David, because I told him about Wavy's cancer, or possible. And he goes, David, take the day off. I go, okay, the rest of the day off. Thank you, chief. So I drive him to this, and I'm watching him. I mean, he's out there talking. I'm watching him, and my phone is going off, 911, 911, 911. And I'm watching him. I always had my eye on him. I get the call. I call my mom up. I think it was my sister Anna is calling me. She's saying, David, she goes, our dad just went into a coma. This is on the 27th. And that afternoon, I have an appointment with my wife to get her results. And I had promised her that I was not going to go through the process with my dad's operation if she had cancer. I had promised her, given her my word. We're men of our word. So this is all in one day, all in one day. And this is how things happen, RJ, Luca, Anaya, and Elijah. This is how things happen. They don't just, sometimes they just happen overnight, hours. And I'm there. My mom is saying, Anna saying, the ambulance just took our dad. He's in a coma. He's going to die. They're taking him to Kaiser in Mission Valley. You need to go give him his last rites. Our father is dying. And I'm all, okay. So by now, it's already going to be 1 o'clock. I tell the chief, he finishes speaking. I go drive, drop him off. And I'm on the phone with my sister. How's he doing? Well, you know what? You better come. And as I'm driving to pick up my wife, I tell her, she goes, you promised me. And I go, I understand. I understand. Let's go get your results. And I'm thinking, man, God, please don't let it be cancer. We walk in, the doctor sits us down, and he tells her, you know what, it's cancer, and it's growing faster than what we thought it was going to grow, and you need to have a mastectomy, a one-breast mastectomy immediately. He tells her that. Wavy looks at me, tears are coming down her eyes, and I'm like, I cannot believe this is happening all within a 12-hour period. My dad this morning was great, and all of a sudden, he's in a coma. My wife is getting news that she's having cancer. And I'm looking at her and she's looking at me saying, hug me. So I give her a hug. And she says, you told me you weren't. Because I've told her my dad gotten worse. He's on his way to the hospital and he's going to die. And I'm going to call the doctor, see if we could expedite. He goes, you promised me. And I remember when Wavy got in the car and I'm driving and I'm thinking, what am I going to do? And she's looking at me. She says, you promised me. And I did. I promised her. I remember we drove over to her house, to her mom and dad's house. And they were all, her mom was crying. They were crying. And I get my father-in-law, my wife. That's one thing. She loved her father. And I bring him off to the side. I go, listen, Joe. And I loved him. He was like a second father to me. And I go, this is a predicament that I'm in. The doctor says that we're having this surgery tomorrow. I need to save my father's life. I promise your daughter. And if I keep my promise, after my dad dies, our marriage is never going to be the same again. There will come a time where I will blame her for my father's death. But I'm a man of my word. And he goes, let me talk to her. So he talked to her. And when he talked to her, Wavy came out. She goes, save your father's life. That's all I needed to hear from her. I mean, I was between literally a rock and a hard place. I was at that point in my life. And I go, let's go see my father. By now, it's 6 o'clock in the afternoon. We get to the hospital. My dad's in a coma. There's 1,000, because my dad was a pastor. Like I said, a lot of people loved him. There's 100 people there at the hospital. And as I walk in, my dad's dying. I call the doctor. I go, doctor. I go, my dad. He goes, David, the operation is over. I go, okay, so no operation. He goes, no, your dad's going to die. The operation is over. He goes, I'm going to transfer him over to UCLA. An ambulance is picking him up any hour, any minute now. They're bringing him to UCLA, and we're going to basically put him to rest here. Come Sunday to give his last rites. By Monday, he's not going to be with us anymore. And I was sad, but I was relieved because I had promised my wife, but I know my dad was going to heaven, so I was okay with it. But I had promised him, and I had promised her. And as I walk in, there's this pastor standing next to my dad. And this man is a man of God. I have the utmost respect for this pastor. I'm not going to mention his name. There's no need. But we believe in prayer. We believe in speaking in tongues. We believe in the movement of the Lord. And as I walk in, this man all of a sudden raises his arms and he starts speaking in tongues over my father. And he starts like prophesizing. And as he's praying, he says, David, the Lord just told me that do not go through this surgery because you are going to die. Get your life right with the Lord. Do not go through this surgery. Well, I had just talked to the doctor. He didn't know that. So in my mind, I'm thinking, well, it's not going to happen. But thank you very much for your message, Pastor. And we left it at that. The next morning, I get up in the morning. I talk to my wife. Sunday morning, we leave my father. They take him to UCLA. And while he's at UCLA, all of a sudden, he wakes up for a moment and he's better. And when I get there, and like I said, we're a big family. And my dad had a lot of people that loved him. There was, I'm not exaggerating, 100 people there at UCLA waiting to go see my father. As we're all in like in a big cafeteria, all of a sudden, it's probably about 3 p.m. My dad went on and off on the coma. Dr. Gobriel, this man right here, he walks in and there's 100 people there. I'm not exaggerating. They're there. I'm with my mom. I'm holding my mom, my sister Anna, my sister Rachel, all the grandchildren, everybody's there. The doctor walks in and he goes, David Contreras Jr. And I'm holding her. And I go, yes, doctor. Hey, Dr. Gobriel, because I mean, I had known him. He did a lot of my testing. And he goes, are you ready? I go, excuse me? He goes, are you ready? I go, ready for what? He goes, tomorrow morning, 7:30 in the morning. He goes, your father just went up. His levels went up. We have a 70% chance of recovery. Tomorrow morning at 7:30, we're doing the live liver donor transplant. Guys, I didn't have pajamas. I didn't have anything. Nothing at all. Nothing at all. All I had was just basically I was there to give my dad the last rites. I was there to give his last rites. And I remember I looked at him and I look at my wife. My wife's eyes fly open because now my wife in 4 days is going to have a mastectomy for one of her breasts because to remove the cancer cells. And I'm looking at her. And she already had given me the green light, but now I've already thought that it's over, but it's not over. And I remember I looked at the doctor and he goes, are you ready? Just like that. And everybody, you know, like when E.F. Hunt speaks, everybody listens. Everybody was yelling, talking. But when he said those words, you could hear a pin drop. I remember I looked at him He looks at me and he goes, are you ready at 7:30 in the morning? Tomorrow's a surgery. I go, doctor, I go, is there a Kmart? I swear to God, I said, is there a Kmart around here? Back then, 2003, there was Kmarts. I go, is there a Kmart? He goes, I'm sure there's one around here. I go, I need to go to Kmart. I need to go get pajamas. I need to get pajamas for my kids. I need to get pajamas for us. We need to get a hotel. I mean, literally from 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we go get, and then at five, I was admitted in. They put an enema in me, and I am literally, I mean, everything is coming out, and I am confused. I am confused. And now I'm thinking, that preacher said not to do it. I'm going to die. And that thought keeps going through my mind. But what happened that night, they couldn't keep us on the same floor because we had the same name. David Contreras, I'm David Contreras Jr. So they had him on the floor above me. They had me on the second floor. They put me on the floor where other liver transplant donors were at. And I remember that night, there were men, grown men, walking with pillows holding their guts together. And they were screaming in pain. Oh, and I would tell the nurse, what happened? He goes, they went to a live liver donor transplant. This is the pain that they're in. And as I'm watching this, I'm thinking, what the heck did I get myself into? And by now, literally Sunday night, I'm calling Chief David Bejarano. Chief, I know I told you that this, he knew about the operation, but it wasn't going to be till September. Now it's literally April 28th. That tomorrow, I go, Chief, tomorrow I'm having the operation. He goes, David, are you prepared? I go, Chief, ready or not? My father's going to die if I don't do it. And he goes, don't worry about it. We'll take care of your work. Don't worry about it, man. I'll give you vacation time, TO time, whatever you need. He goes, you got enough hours? I go, yes, I do, Chief. I got plenty of hours. And he goes, you got the green light. He goes, I'll go see you. And I go, thank you very much, Chief. So I'm preparing all this. I'm preparing this. And literally, I mean, within 24 hours, our whole life changed. That night, at 3 o'clock in the morning, I remember they gave me a nightgown, and the nightgown only tied through the butt. And I didn't have underwear on because they had that enema stuck in me. And I remember I'm laying there, and I called the nurse at 3 a.m. because, to be honest with you, RJ, Luca, Anaya, and Elijah, I was going to leave. I was going to leave. I told myself, I want to continue being a cop. I don't want to die. I can't. And I kept telling myself, Dad, I'm sorry. I can't do this. And I remember I called the nurse and I go, please remove everything from me, the tubes, everything. I go, I need to go see my father. But in my mind, it was to say goodbye. I was going to come back, put my clothes on and get the hell out of there. I mean, people screaming, people in pain. This preacher kept going through my mind. I'm going to die. I'm never going to see my family. I'm never going to be a cop. I always wanted to be a cop as a little boy. I'm finally a cop. And all this is happening within literally 12-hour period. And it's moving. It's moving. And I remember at 3 o'clock in the morning, she takes everything out. And I remember I jumped up and I go, she goes, the elevator's right there. He's on the floor. Just tell him you're David Contreras. See your father. And I remember walking and I had my butt showing because I wasn't even thinking. I remember one nurse comes. She goes, oh, she ties a little thing around me. They were all laughing. And I go, where's my father? She goes, right there. And I remember I went over there and he's laying there and he's in a coma. And I looked at him. And I remember as I'm looking at him, all of a sudden, tears started going down my eyes. And I go, you know, you gave me life. And I have the opportunity to save yours. And I'm scared because I may never see my family again. I may never be a cop again. I may never be the same again. I go, but you know, you sacrificed your life for me. And you know what? I love you and I'm not going to leave. And I remember I reached out and I kissed him. I got up. I went back and told the nurse, all right, take me back. She told me there's the elevator. I went back. And I remember my wife got there about 4 o'clock in the morning. And I never told her what that preacher said to me. That preacher kept going through my mind. And I remember at 7 o'clock in the morning, Monique, Vanessa, Little Dave, and Wavy was already there. They get there. And I remember as they're prepping me to take me into surgery, I remember looking at them and just thinking, this will probably be the last day, last time that I will ever see them. And I'm telling God, please forgive me. I know I've sinned against you. I know I've done so many things. I live without you, and please. And but I was always that guy that didn't want to do that. You know what I mean? And I go, please. But I never said, give me another chance. I just said, please. You know what? Save my father. That's all that was going through my mind. Save my father. Take me, save my father, but forgive me. And I remember, I'll never forget, as they're taking me, I keep, the nurse is pulling me, and my head is looking at my kids and my wife as they're walking me to the elevator. And I remember when the elevator door opened, I felt like I am never going to see you again. Because that preacher kept going through my mind. And when that elevator opened, they brought me in. I go, turn me around, because they had my legs going in. I would have had to do this to see my kids. I go, I'm going to see them before that elevator closes. And I remember when that elevator door closed, I looked at them, and I could still see them today. I could still see them. They're crying, and I'm weeping. The door closes, and now I'm like, okay, Lord, let's do it. Now I'm set. I'm ready to go home. No more crying, no more nothing. They take me in. I remember, I know what the morgue feels like. They took me in. It was freezing in there. They put me on a cold slab, and I remember they started, you know, prepping me, and they put the mask on. They go count to 10 backwards, and I'm thinking, this is the last time. And I remember it all looked black and white. It was all gray in there, and it was dark. And they didn't even put music on. And I see Dr. Gabriel come in. He goes, Dave. And I remember he gave me thumbs up, and I look at him. I'm going, that's the last thing. I swear, I'm thinking, that's the last thing I'm going to see. And I start counting down, 10, 9, 8. By 8, I was gone. The surgery lasted. Surgery lasted over 16 hours, 16 hours. They opened me up, and during the day, the doctor would come. All the family was in the cafeteria. One of the times the doctor came out, it had been like 8 hours. And my wife looks at him. He goes, doctor, where are we at? He goes, we haven't even taken the liver out. And my wife goes, what do you mean? She goes, we've been prepping him. And he goes, your husband is a movie star up there. He's a star. And my wife looked at him. She goes, what do you mean he's a star? He goes, he's famous. He goes, we have never seen a liver so big in our life. He goes, what does this man eat? What is he made of? Out of? He goes, we have never seen a liver so big. He goes, people are coming in from other hospitals to look at your husband's liver. And my wife goes, okay, it's a little bit more information that I needed, but what's going on? He goes, we're going to now prep. We've already taken my liver out. We're going to prep his father, and we're going to go ahead and make the transplant. What I remember very clearly was the following, I don't even know, it was 1 or 2 days, but I remember waking up. And I remember when I woke up, I had Vaseline all over my eyes. And I remember when I woke up, I'm looking around, it was daylight, and I remember when I took my first breath, I could not breathe. I was like, I could not breathe because they had broken 5 ribs to get to this enlarged liver that was perfectly healthy, but they had to break 5 ribs to get it. It was abnormal for them to do that. But I remember as I woke up, there was a gentleman, his name is Jesse Suniga. He was a Los Angeles police. I believe he was a police officer with the Los Angeles. He was married to my cousin, Samantha Suniga. And he had heard that I was there at the hospital. And he went basically to stand by my side when I woke up to make sure that nobody got near me. And I remember waking up, seeing him. I had never met the gentleman in my life. And he tells me, I'm your cousin. I worked LAPD. I worked Metro. And he's telling me all this as I'm looking at him. And I remember just telling him, I can't see you. Please wipe my eyes. I couldn't even move my hands. I was under so much pain. Well, after that, I was in the hospital for about a week and a half. When I came out of the hospital, my wife went immediately. They basically delayed her surgery until I got out. I got home. She went straight. Actually, that morning, she went to the hospital to get her cancer operation on her breast. I got home, and Chief David Bejarano took the day off to stay with me there at my home while she was having surgery. She comes home. My sister Rachel took care of us. But going back to the hospital, I was there, like I said, for a week and a half. I had Chris Kilby, Kincaid, Bobby Hernandez, Eric Morales. I mean, so many, Linda Tibbetts, so many of cops went all the way to L.A. to see me. And I wanted to thank you. And I know there's so many of you that I don't remember. I was so loaded on morphine that I don't remember Rudy Tai. I remember you were, I remember a lot of people were there, and my brothers in blue and my brothers in Christ were there during the time. But what I want to say is I will never forget that, because you know what? My dad ended up living 6 more years, and those 6 years, I took advantage of them. I was with them every day. I mean, before I would go to work, by now, it took me 3 months to go back to work. And I never thought I would be able to lift again. I never thought I would be able to be a cop again. But you know what? I remember when I got out for about 2 weeks, I couldn't sleep because of the pain. I would walk around my neighborhood with a pillow, just like those men, at 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, walking with pajamas and my slippers, walking my neighborhood with a pillow. Because you know what? The ribs, the it was very painful, but you know what? I finally healed. I finally went back to work, and God blessed me with a wonderful career. And God, my wife, the cancer never came back. But there's going to be times, grandchildren, or you that are watching this show, there's going to be times that you're going to be faced with a situation like this or worse. And you know what? You have to do the right thing. You have to do the right thing and be prepared, because you know what? You never know when you're going to be faced with a circumstance like this.
Wow.
Go ahead, Chalo.
David, wow. Woo. Hey, David. Oof. Heavy, bro.
You know what, Chalo, before you answer that, let me just tell you, ask me the next question. My father, before he died, he ended up living, but he got dementia. He ended up dying from dementia. And my dad, the last maybe 8, 9 months, last year, before I was working gangs at the time, and I would go before we'd start at 2 o'clock, and at 12 o'clock, I'd spend 2 hours every day. I'd spend 2 hours with him. I'd take him for walks, and I saw how dementia was eating him up. At the end, he didn't know who I was. So he would call me Jose, Manuel, Juan. He didn't know who I was. So at his funeral, when Andy Mills, that's why he's so special to me, when he went to Israel, I had him bring me a rock from the Garden of Gethsemane. That's where Jesus prayed his last prayer. And in my dad's funeral, when I spoke, I took that rock because I wore it on my neck for years, because I knew that someday I was going to speak at his funeral. I took off my chain. I took off the rock. And in front of 4,000 people, I placed the rock inside of his lapel of his suit. I place it in his pocket, and I go, Dad, I know here on earth you didn't know who I was the last year. You called me Jose, you called me Manuel, you called me Juan, but when I get to heaven, you're gonna know who I am, because I'm gonna ask for that rock back. And I never forgot that, Chalo. I mean, that I love my father. My father, man, it was a blessing for me to do what I did for him. And if I had the chance to do it again, I would do it again 100 times. And I would suffer the pain, because you know what? When you love somebody, you're willing to sacrifice everything you have for them, because he was an honorable, honorable man.
Well, Sean, I think it's your next, right? In five.
Yeah, I don't know how to follow that, to be honest with you. That was an intense story there, David.
It is.
You know, I am so proud of you, and you know, and you and Wavy.
Yeah.
You know, we're going through what you guys had to go through, and look where you're at today. You know.
Yeah.
And with the family and everything. Okay.
You know, real quick, like, and I just, mm-hmm. I mean, I think this is the right time to say this. So, we all know that my family, we're going through some stuff. and David offered to fly from Florida, go pick up my son and bring him home to me, because maybe there was something going on with my back and everything. And man, after you hear the story, brother, you know, David, God bless you, bro.
It's who we are, Chalo. It's who we are. It's who we are. We're sheepdogs. It's who we are.
Yeah. And not too many people, man. I got a lot of so-called friends, and you know, they don't know what's going on, but I mean, I don't know. I mean, if anybody would have said, hey, you know what, dude, I I'm retired. I'm closer than you are. I can hop on a plane, bro. Go get your son. And that way you don't have to go out, you know, your back is messed up right now, and you don't have to go out there and do it. Dude, I'll take him and I'll drive him home to you and take him home. And man, that means so much for me, my family, dude. And I appreciate it, bro. Love you, bro.
Thank you. Thank you, Chalo. And I mean it. Yeah, I meant it.
Yeah.
Guys, there's two more questions. One of them, what advice would I give to active and retired first responders? And I wrote them down, and I'll say them real quick. Guys, if you're a cop today or if you're retired, love what you do. Love going to work. When you love going to work, when you love being out on patrol, when you love investigating, you know what? Like my father said, I worked for 32 years and as a police officer, and I never worked one day of my life because I loved what I did. The second thing is live a purpose-driven life, driven and mission-oriented life. Second of all, have the heart of a servant. Guys, we're servants. We're there to serve. Have the heart of a servant with the mentality of a warrior. With that mentality, guys, just remember that your grandmother lives in your beat. Your family lives in some other cop's beat. So treat people with respect. Have the heart of a servant. Three, the pen is mightier than the sword. It took me years to realize that. And I learned that while working for the Department of Corrections. We thought that using force was, no, the pen is mightier than the sword. The fourth one, you can't get more bears with honey than with vinegar. Be nice, be respectful. By smiling, by listening, you could get so much more than trying to be a tough guy. The fifth one, question everyone and everything. Don't believe anything. The reason why I was a good cop, because I never believed anybody. And I don't care who they were, I never believed them until they proved me right. Never believe anybody. And the last one is, under the right circumstances, develop confidential informants by creating and capitalizing the right circumstances. Without informants, our work is hard. You develop informants, I'm telling you, you will definitely be a great cop by developing. Once you develop those informants, maintain a relationship with them. Doesn't mean you're going to invite them over for lunch, but guys, every one of my informants, I knew what kind of coffee they drank every Christmas. Yes, my wife, I would tell her, you know what? I would go to different stores and buy Christmas gifts, because who are these for? They're for my informant's kids. And who's this food for my informant who's in prison, for his mother? You know what? You do those extra things, one day they will save your life. And someday we'll come back and I'll talk about how one informant saved both Oscar and my life. And guys, I think the last question, I'm going to go ahead and just say it real quick. This is very dear to me. Life advice for my grandchildren. And RJ, Luca, Anaya, and Elijah, this advice is from you. Remember this. Always be truthful and learn how to say no. Remember that. It is better to turn red one time than 1,000 times later. Learn how to say no. When you're 30 years old, when you're 20 years old, when you're 15 years old, and somebody comes and offers you drugs, somebody comes and offers you to do something that is not right, learn how to say no. The second advice, I just got four quick advices for you because I love you. And someday I'm going to die. You're never going to see me again, but you're going to see this video. You're going to remember this. The second one is, never ask or lend money to anyone. The reason why I'm telling you this is because if you can't afford it, then don't buy it. Wait till you can. If you lend a friend money, he will no longer be your friend. if you lend a relative money, he will no longer be your relative, because sometimes different circumstances, they can't pay you. So if they can't pay you, they're going to ignore you and run from you. So you're going to lose friendships. If you have the money, if they ask you for 500 and you have 100, give them 100. If you have the 500, give it to them. But never lend money. Give it to them. And if you can't, learn how to say no. The third one, there's only four. Always be humble and kind. Guys, I don't care if you play football. I don't care how famous you are, how much of a wallflower you are. Always be humble and kind to everybody. Have the heart of a servant. Have the heart of a servant and the mindset of a warrior. Don't ever let anybody take your kindness for a weakness. But yet, you know what? Show kindness to people. But when they cross the line, take care of it. I took care of it. And we all take care of it. And the last one is learn to give, never expecting nothing in return. Never give, unless if you're working as a cop and it's an informant, you're developing, of course, you're going to get something in return. But in life, if you're going to give something to somebody, never expect nothing in return. The more you give, remember this, guys, and Anaya, the more you give, the more you receive. I'm a witness to that. And the last two pictures that I have, guys, and I'm finished, is this man right here. You see me, I'm at the fights here with my son-in-law, Bobby, and this is his father, Bob Hernandez. Elijah RJ and Luca, you have, through your father's father, Robert Hernandez, was a warden of Donovan State Prison. The man is a legend in the California Department of Corrections. You have that man's mentality, leadership running through your veins. You have my heart. You have my heart of a servant, of a warrior running through your veins. So as you get older and you're faced with circumstances, remember the blood that runs through your veins and remember this advice. And this picture down below is my son-in-law, Calvin's father, Elijah and Anaya. You have that man. That man was a police officer. That man was a legend in India. And I'm telling you, a legend in India in law enforcement. You have that man's blood running through you, and you have my blood, the blood of a servant, the blood of a warrior running through your veins. When you're faced through circumstances and you're faced with different situations in life, follow through. Because remember, I did it, Bobby, the warden did it, and your grandfather in India did it. With that said, God bless you, and I wish you, man, watch this video when you get older. Thank you.
Wow, dude.
That's it, guys. A minute, an hour and 42 minutes, but you know what? They don't have to watch it, but my grandchildren one day will, and hopefully one word that I said, somebody's going through something, this is going to help them push through, because you know what? We never give up.
Right.
Benny, it's all yours.
Well, David, first thing I want to know, I have a question for you. Mm-hmm. How do you want your friends and your family to remember you? And when I talk about friends, remember, we know a lot of people, and those are not really our friends. I'm talking about real solid friends. How do you want to be remembered?
First of all, I want to ask forgiveness, because I know I've let a lot of people down throughout my life, and friends, you know. And second of all, as a servant, a man that gave, never expecting nothing in return, a man that was a warrior, a man that wasn't afraid to do the right thing, and just, you know who you are. I'm not going to mention names, because I know you five know who you are. I call you every day. I call you. We talk on the phone. You know who you are, and you know what? Thank you. Thank you. And just know that, you know what? A warrior and a servant, and above all, a servant. And, you know, Benny, 3 years ago, I rededicated my life to the Lord. I hadn't cried in a long time. I hadn't felt the Spirit of God. But 3 years ago, 36 years I lived without God. And 3 years ago, I rededicated my life to the Lord. And those friends, I want you to know that I will see you again in heaven someday. And we will all cherish eternity together. But a servant and a warrior.
Well, thank you, David, and it's an honor to have you as a friend, bro.
Thank you, brother.
Truly. Thank you. Truly.
Yeah.
So let's talk about next week. Sean, you and David know him better than I do. So can one of you guys please tell us who next week's guest is?
It's all yours, Sean.
Thanks. It's the new police chief, Scott Wall, for San Diego. And, you know, we've known him since he was a baby cop. I believe his father was a sergeant on our department at one point. And, you know, he's moved up the ranks, and he was selected as the new police chief after Chief Neslight retired. So I know that he's jumped in there with both feet, and he's made some significant changes. And we're going to be talking to him about some of the issues that have come up since he's been taken over as the chief. We've had officer death and some other issues that were going on.
And Benny, I'm excited to talk to him. I've known him since he became a police officer. I knew his father. I worked around his father. His father conducted probably one of the most highest profile cases on the Mexican Mafia in San Diego. And we're going to talk about it next week. I'm excited to talk to him, remind him of the great work his father was assigned to NTF like his whole career. His father was a legend, man. I can't wait. Maybe someday we'll have his father on as well, but I'm excited. Yeah. But yeah. Benny, with that said, can I just announce real quick, tomorrow on Ash Wednesday, we got retired DEA supervisor special agent and author Leo Silva. He was working Matamoros and Tamaulipas when the Zeta started. Me and Benny just ordered his book. He's going to be on our show tomorrow talking about his book and talking about Los Zetas. So tomorrow on Ash Wednesday, join us. It's going to be a great episode. And Benny, you and I talk. He's coming in on the gray line next.
Right.
As soon as you're ready. I'm done.
Yeah. And you know, people, if you cannot watch our episodes on YouTube, you can listen to us on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, CastBox, Google Podcasts, Pod Paradise, Postpay, Castro, and Overcast. I mean, you can listen to our show. I'm going to be uploading David's episode hopefully tonight. If we're not having any issues with YouTube. But like I said, I was able to watch the whole interview on Facebook on both pages. So hopefully it's nothing to do with YouTube. But hopefully it was just a glitch in the system.
Yeah, you know, Benny, it could have been that instead of using your internet, you were using dial-up, so maybe that's what messed up.
I don't know.
I just have to laugh, bro. I mean, it's crying, bro. Yeah.
There's a picture.
And your grandkids, David, Google or whatever search engine is dial-up. Internet and you'll get
they will get it. Yeah.
When the internet slows down, it does not compare to the way we used to do it.
What was that first internet service?
AOL. You got mail.
Well, hey guys, we're going on 2 hours. Sean, any last words, my brother?
No, great episode, great career, great family, Dave. And I am proud to say that I'm one of your friends.
Yeah, you are.
And I hold you dear to my heart, bro.
Yeah. Big Benny.
You know, same thing, same as Sean. You know, I'm honored to have you guys as my friend. I mean, you guys are solid. You guys are all solid.
Yeah. Without a doubt. And, you know, hearing your stories, legendary stories, what a blessing that we're able to tell. And then we're going to hear Chalo. The first week of or 2 weeks of December, we can't wait. Chalo, last words.
Well, you know, David, it's in I'm a firm believer, and like I said, you know, I just like you did, you know, I received Christ back in my heart, and then I actually got baptized at the beginning of this year. This is beautiful. I got baptized. I was reborn on my terms, not our Catholic faith. Where, you know, and I'm not gonna mock the Catholic Church because I loved it. I love people in it. My mom still. But I think now I understand that, you know, baptism is a tradition in that church. But God put us all together for a reason, dude. I mean, we all knew that, you know, we've leaned on each other, you know, when, you know, sometimes when we have little things going and with our health or families, and just to have the brotherhood that we have, you know, like they say, you know, family is not, it's not always blood, you know, family is us, dude.
Amen.
You know, because you can have blood relatives, which is great if you get along with them, but sometimes you end up finding out that, you know, you've always been taking care of family, and then when you need them, they're not there for you. And so the ones that are there for you are your friends, man. You know, you guys, the brothers, not just friends, because like we said before, we have acquaintances and they're friends, your true friends. You know who your true friends when you're going through through things that your trials in life.
Yeah, so, that's a fact. Yeah.
Without doubt, Benny, once again, from the bottom of my heart, those two videos that you made for me, oh my God, I'm telling you, they are beautiful. Thank you. And those of you, we'll see you tomorrow night on Ash Wednesday. God bless you. And I hope this story, hopefully, when you're going through something in your life, that it will motivate you to basically call upon God, because God will always answer. Thank you. God bless you. Goodbye.
Teardrop for one heart to carry on. You're way on top now. Since you left me, you're always laughing way down at me. But watch out now. Together for just a little while, and then I'm gonna put you way down here, and you'll start crying 96 tears. Comes up, I'll be on top. You be right down there looking up, and I might wave, come up here, but I don't see you waving now. I'm way down here wondering how I'm gonna get to you, but I know now I'll just cry. For one heart to be crying, too many teardrops for one heart to carry on. You're gonna cry 96 tears.